Jan. As you can see, she has a problem. On rollers, the box moves easily. But this might not be the best solution to her problem. It's a bore to have to keep on fetching the rollers. What other ways could she have found to solve her problem? Of course, none of these may be any better than rollers. Thinking through a problem like this. It's called the design process. And we're going to use it to tackle a particular problem, how to design a vehicle. If we follow this design process, it will take us through four stages. To begin with, you need to be sure you understand exactly what the problem is that you're trying to solve. What sort of things do you... This class is going to design a vehicle to go downhill. But before they can begin, they need to be quite clear what the problem is. For example, what is a vehicle?
Pictures of different sorts of vehicles. What sort of things do you think they might have in common? Anything at all? Anything at all? Anything you notice?
They all have steering.
They all have a means of steering, don't they? I think that's probably true, don't they? Even those, you can steer them, can't you, by turning one way or the other?
Once they have decided exactly what their problem is, they are ready for the next stage. The planning stage. This means looking at various solutions and choosing the best one of your ideas for whatever it is you are going to make. You can use drawings in two ways, to try out your ideas, or as these children are doing, to make working drawings from which to build your vehicles. Before spending a lot of time and expensive materials on the final object, it's worth making a cardboard or wooden model to see if your ideas will work. The making stage comes next. We'll be giving you some hints on how to use various tools for working with wood, metal, and plastics. Once you've finished making your vehicle, you'll need to test it to see if it works. And if not, you'll have to go back, think about it again, and correct any faults in it. As we see groups of children designing vehicles, we shall be reminding you of these four stages again. Jan now has a new problem. She wants to build a wheeled vehicle to carry her downhill, but that raises a number of questions. Where should the wheels be attached? How should they be attached? Where should Jan sit? How will it be steered? And so on. There are many other questions she could ask, and they're exactly the sort of questions this class is asking about the model downhill vehicles they're going to make.
Okay. Now, what are some of the things that you'll need to think about when you're drawing your ideas out for that? What are some of the things you're going to need to think about for that?
Make sure the wheels are the right shape.
All right, wheels. Wheels are the things that you're going to need to think about, aren't they? What else are you going to need to think about?
Wheel position.
Right, wheel position. Okay, what else?
How many wheels?
Right.
Next, they can begin sketching out their ideas. It's a good idea to try things out on paper before launching into the making stage. No, I don't think much of that. Still too rounded. Perhaps straight lines. That's better, but I wanted something racier looking. Nearly right. That's what I want. When you've settled on the basic shape and decided how to put your vehicle together, you can make some working drawings. Side view. And plan. With measurements written on the drawings, you're ready to use them to make the finished object. But before we get to that, there are still some questions to be answered about the wheels and how they are to be attached.
What else is important? Supposing we had it too high up. Could we have it too high up, or could we have it too low down? Or is it important whereabouts it goes?
Well, if it's too low,
yes.
The vehicle would be too high up off the ground.
It might be too high up off the ground. What would happen if it was too high up?
Scrape on the floor.
Yes, that's right. The roller, the wheel wouldn't actually touch the floor, would it? So we've got to think about that carefully with that one. We've got one last one here where a hole's been drilled in and the axle is fixed. The hole that's been drilled in is very tight. Can you turn that? Will it turn? No. So that axle is very tight and it sticks straight into the side and the wheel rolls about on it. Now, what have we got to be careful with there?
That the wheel doesn't come off.
Yes, we've got to be careful.
Making or finding wheels and attaching them to a vehicle is likely to be one of the most difficult jobs. Here are some ideas which might help. These are plastic lids glued together. They already have a hole in them. The hole in these wheels is quite large, so you'd need to use a thick axle or find a way to make the hole smaller. You can also do that with these rubber wheels. Thick dowel can be cut into sections to make wheels, but you might find it difficult to drill a hole exactly in the centre. One of the best ways is to cut wheels out of plywood with a hole saw and glue them to an axle, or you might want to attach them separately. Here's a way of making the hole smooth using the end cap of a ballpoint pen. A wheel has to be attached somehow, and however you do it, you're going to have to find a way of making the wheels or axles turn freely. Here's the way that the bicycle designer overcomes that problem.
He's lost it. Keep yours still.
This one's going down as well.
What about the other side? Oh, wait a minute. What's happening? Here they go. Here they go. Yeah, they're dropping out. What are they? What do they do?
They help the wheel go round. The spindle.
Well, the spindle's fixed the bike, isn't it? So the spindle isn't turning. What turns? Do you think it would work as well without the ball bearings?
Yeah.
Do you think that? I wonder if you've got any idea just how much difference they make.
Just try this. It's ever so simple. Some marbles. Put a row of marbles around one tin and turn the other tin upside down on it. But do that first. Just to prove to yourself that it doesn't fly around like Concorde, does it? No, okay, now try it with some marbles in the tin. All right, don't think you'll manage that one. Okay, now put the other tin upside down. That's it. Carefully. Now turn. See if you can get up some speed, Earl. Pretty good. Okay. Where else do you think you might find ball bearings? Have a look over there. What can you see on the
skateboard? Skateboard inside the.
Oh yeah.
What, near the all right. Well, let's find out. Go and get it. Let's take the wheel off. It. Okay. Now all you want is a span on that. Hold it for you. This one wheel on the skateboard has been greased because it's been apart before and put back together again. But what have you found?
Ball bearing surface.
You probably won't be able to use ball bearings, but you will need to think about ways of reducing friction.
Got less friction in that one, but on the other hand, that wobbles. So what? How could you stop that wobbling and yet still have a minimum amount of friction in the middle?
You could glue the axle into that and then have something like this so that the axle would turn.
And the axle would turn?
Yeah.
That means you've got to turn, as that goes along, you've got to turn both wheels together and the axle, isn't it?
Another thing to think about, will you need some kind of steering? Mark and Rodney thought that rails might help to make their vehicle run straight.
We've got to make this one as well. What? This one is onto the post. It's too near. It's out too far. You can't not get it.
Steering was only one of the problems this class had to overcome. They had decided to make a go-kart large enough to carry a driver.
What are the problems involved? Or what kind of problems are we going to have? Yes?
We're going to have to decide on what ground it's going to be.
Other problems involved with your go-kart? Michelle?
Steering,
right. How might we steer the vehicle? Ashley?
We could use handlebars, bicycle bent back.
Right. Any other way?
The steering wheel.
With the steering wheel? Ian?
With your feet.
Yes, Samantha.
What materials will we use to build it? People it's going to carry.
Yes, Ian?
Tall, thin. How heavy they weigh.
What's the appearance going to be like?
What the appearance of the go-kart's going to be, yes.
How much would it cost?
Any other problems? Craig?
Safety.
The safety aspect, yes. Very important, in fact. How are you going to solve that problem, safety?
And fix the seatbelt in.
You need perhaps to fix the seatbelt in. What else?
A roll bar at the top.
You might need a roll bar, yes. Anything else?
The strength of it.
Because of the large amounts of expensive materials a go-kart uses, and the importance of safety with a vehicle carrying a person, a great deal of time was spent in the planning stage.
It turns the wheels.
And what about you?
At this stage, no idea should be ruled out, however ridiculous it might seem at first. It's only through discussion and experiment that any unsuitable suggestions can be eliminated.
To help break.
Have you got any indication of how you're going to make that parachute work?
No.
You just thought you'd like a parachute on?
Yes.
Can you explain, Raymond, how the steering mechanism on your vehicle works?
You put your feet onto the two pedals there and you push that one and bring your leg back on that one and it tilts the wheels to the side.
Over to the right or to the left?
Yes. From the top of his head to the floor is 61. From the bottom of his foot
up to his knee is 42.
Children can discover for themselves that the design of something should take into account the measurements of the person using it.
The height of his foot is 23. From the elbow to the shoulder is 24. Heel position to the back of seat, 67.
These are the brakes of one of the vehicles. And of the other.
You mustn't have it upright like that. You must have it very strong like it, okay? There we are, see, like that. We go through there, like that. Now, is that all the way through? Take it out and have a look.
Finally, before making the full-sized go-karts, they tried out their ideas with small models.
Yeah, it fits. Spin it round. Let's see if it's spinning. Right. Good, that's it, that's fine, that's lovely. That's it.
Right. It works anyway.
Yeah.
Right, okay, let's you've got the wheels on there.
Yeah.
Right. Okay, come and have a look at this. Right, now let's put it on this. Stop you doing this. Now let's have a look at your. That's the footrest, isn't it?
Yeah.
Right, let's put that on there. Right, okay. I'll put that on there. Right. So.
Remember, these are just models. You'll have to wait till next time to find out how they got on with the full sized go karts. Okay. The design stages that we have been talking about are exactly like those used by a professional designer. This car designer starts off by roughly sketching out his ideas. Once he's reasonably happy with his drawing, he produces a final styling. Then he produces working drawings. These are copied onto the wood out of which he can make a full-sized model. The designer is not only thinking about what his vehicle looks like, but he also needs to think about whether it will work well. Here it is being tested in a wind tunnel to make sure that the air flows smoothly over it. Before a new car can be made, there are sure to be many problems to solve. And that's what designing is all about, asking and answering questions. Jan has answered all her design questions. Or has she? You wouldn't use rubber for a bike. So what would you use?
Hold it there. Come.
To find out what a bicycle is made of, these children are taking one apart.
What we're going to do now is I want you to tell me what you think each part is made of. Well, you can tell me what they think the wheel's made of. Furnace.
Steel.
Probably some kind of steel. What are these bits called?
Spokes.
The spokes, yes. And what do you think they're made of?
Steel.
Steel, the same thing, yeah. Not all metal, is it? What's there? What can you see?
If you do this yourself, don't just think about what materials have been used. Think also about how they've been used and why. The frame is made of metal. Why is it painted? And why is it the shape it is? Can you see two triangles? That's a clue. A bicycle frame could be made of solid metal. The earliest ones were, but now they're hollow. Why do you think tubing is used instead? Or what about the wheels? Why are there spokes? The wheel could be a solid disc. And the tires. Why rubber? You could ask questions like these about all the parts of a bicycle. Deciding which materials to use and how to use them is part of the design process we met in the first programme. Before we see how our downhill vehicles are getting on, let's see those four stages again. First, you must decide exactly what the problem is you're trying to solve. Then, having decided what to do, you need to plan how to do it. In this programme, we're going to look at the second two stages. When we're talking about making the things you've designed, we'll give you some hints on how to use tools. And when it's made, you'll need to test it to make sure it really does solve your problem. Let's see how the downhill vehicles are getting on. With all the planning complete, it's time to start making the parts, except that wood doesn't always come in the right lengths. Before you can cut it up, you need to measure it and mark it out carefully. Otherwise, the pieces won't fit together. Let's see how to do that. A tri-square is used to be sure of getting a right angle. Once you've marked out the wood, you can cut it. What kind of saw should you use? That depends on what you want to do. For cutting straight lines across the wood, you should use a tenon saw. A bench hook will protect the desk and help hold the wood still. A junior hacksaw with a wood cutting blade can also be used for small pieces of wood. Larger pieces may need to be clamped to a stool or desk and cut with a panel saw. To get a smooth finish, you can cut a piece slightly larger than you want and plane or rasp it to the right size. A coping saw has a very thin blade, so you can cut curves with it. A sharp knife cuts easily through balsa and fingers, so use a safety ruler. Before the pieces can be put together, Ashley and Ian are drilling holes for the screws. Craig and Peter are making a hole for the steering. Why do you think they are using a different tool?
Yeah.
Here is the reason. Small holes for screws and model axles can be drilled using a wheel brace or hand drill. By using a countersink bit, the heads of the screws can be made to lie level with the surface. For large holes, like those for axles on the go-karts, you need a brace and bit. Once all the pieces are carefully measured and cut out, You have to put them together. John decided to make his model out of balsa, so he can join them with glue. How you put your models together will depend on what materials you've chosen to make them out of. For small models, a glue might be suitable. Most packs of glue tell you what jobs they are best for. Nails are useful for joining wood quickly, but screws will fix the pieces together more strongly. Here's a way you mightn't have thought of. Holes have been drilled through both pieces of wood, exactly the same diameter as these short lengths of dowel. The go-karts are now nearing completion. As each part is assembled, it is tested. No point in waiting till the end to find that the brakes don't work.
There's a spring. Right. Yeah. Test it.
Other group have already had to change the position of their steering mechanism, and there's still another problem to solve.
Can you show me the brakes working? Okay, right, stop. What's happening? What's the trouble? This one's sticking. Okay, how are you going to sort the problem out?
File it down.
File the brake block down.
Use the rasp then.
Use the rasp to file the brake block down, all right?
Yeah, definitely.
Yes, definitely rubbing.
Try and take a little bit more off, Ashley.
Yeah, that's it.
They solved their problem by using a rasp. What other ways are there of shaping wood? Using a plane is a quick way of smoothing and shaping straight wood. But for curves, a surform or rasp is best. And for a smooth finish, glass paper. Here are two ways of using glass paper, either wrapped around a block or stuck down on a flat board. The model vehicles are also nearly finished, and like the go-karts, each part is tested as it is added. At this point, you could go on and finish the vehicles, but the designers of the go-karts thought they ought to make sure that everything was working before they put the bodies on or painted them.
Here.
Lift it up.
Lift it up. Straight there.
Lift it up. Put it down. It's the way.
Wait.
John was pretty sure his model would work, so he painted it before he finished putting it together. Roger, Simon and Matthew wanted to know whose car would go the furthest, so they decided to test theirs before they painted them. But do they start them off in quite the same way? When you decide how to test your vehicles, think about how to make it a fair test, and make sure that they solve the problem you started off with. Don't be disappointed if your vehicle doesn't go very fast, if you set out to build something to, say, carry a heavy load. The rails seem to work, mostly. These vehicles were designed to push or pull another one with them, and that created other problems. The testing of the vehicles is not necessarily the end of the process. If something isn't right, you'll need to go back to the planning stage and see where you went wrong. Jan has solved the problem of the wheels falling off, but perhaps she should have thought of a way of stopping. Her go-kart needs a brake. Brakes all work in roughly the same way. Friction between the surface of the brake and the wheel stops it turning. Some materials create more friction than others, and so it's important to choose the right material to make a brake pad that works well. That's why rubber or leather is chosen for bicycle brake pads. Let's see what else affects how well a brake works.
Okay, now feel it again. Feel some warmth. That's friction. Okay.
These boys are conducting an experiment to see what effect water has on brakes. To keep the brake pressure the same all the time, they have hung a weight on the brake lever.
Can you turn it? Try hard. Use two hands, you should be able to get it through.
First, the wheel is turned with the brakes dry, and it's hard work. But just a little water, and the brakes no longer work. You can see why you have to be extra careful riding in the rain. A way of increasing the friction in brakes is to use a lever. A lever is a simple machine for making work easier. It has a place to push or pull, a pivot, and a place where the work is done.
Levers help us. I wonder which way they help us on the bicycle itself. How, for instance, does the brake lever help us on the bicycle, Jonathan?
To stop us.
It stops us, yes. Chris, how does that stop us by using that on the bicycle? Can you put the front brake on for us? What's happening now when you put the front brake on?
The cable is pulling the gallipers and the
brake pads are rubbing against the wheel to make the wheel stop.
Right, Ken, I want you to try now to push the brakes on using your fingers. Can you try that? Is it difficult or easy?
It's difficult.
Very difficult to do that, yes. So what does this lever do for us then?
It makes it easier for us.
It makes it easy to put the brake on, doesn't it? Now, this brake lever for the back brake, I have taken away from the lever, and you've just got the cable that has to be pulled to put the back brake on. If you pull it when it's in the lever, it's easy. But I want you, Gurpreet, to try and pull the cable out to put the brake on the back wheel. Hold the cable with one hand and pull the inside with the other. Can you do it? No? Perhaps Jonathan had better have a try. Can you do it, Jonathan? It's difficult, isn't it? Oh, we've talked about levers and what they do for us. Now we're going to see how many levers we can count on our bicycle. Chris, can you point to a lever for me, please? Which lever is that?
Gear lever.
Good boy. Gurpreet, can you think of another lever in the bicycle that you can see, that you can point to?
That one.
What's that one called?
The pedals.
There are quite a few levers on a bicycle.
Yes.
See how many you can find. Now Jan's go-kart is finished. As long as she only wants to go downhill.
That rounds off daytime on 2 for today. There's a whole lot more again tomorrow.